I'm going to begin my today's session with the equation of bisectors. Okay, so we'll be discussing the equation of bisectors of the angle between the lines represented by the homogeneous second degree equation. Okay, so represented by, or you can say given by, homogeneous second degree equation. So right now I'm focusing more on homogeneous second degree. Okay. But later on I will generalize it, even if the pair of straight lines is not represented by a homogeneous equation, but instead represented by a general second degree equation. Okay. Yes, Gaurav, you have any questions? Any other day also? Yes. See, take JE today, KV POI tomorrow. It's fine. Okay. So you have available, lot of time available in between also, right? So you can take it tomorrow also. Tests will be open. Don't worry about it. The same link, you have to go and take it the normal way. Fine. Okay, so let us say we have been provided with a pair of straight lines whose combined equation is a general second degree equation. Okay, now we need to know the equation of the bisectors. I would say you need to know the combined equation of the bisectors. So that will also be a pair of straight lines only, right? So here, please understand, in the last class we discussed that a pair of straight lines whose equation is given by a homogeneous equation, that will always be two lines passing through the origin. Okay, so let's say one line is like this, another line is like this. So that will always represent a pair of straight lines passing through the origin. Okay, so let this line be y equal to m1x, this line be y equal to m2x. And we had also learned in the last class, what is the relationship between M1, M2, H, A, and B? Can somebody tell me what is that relation? If you want, you can write it on your chat box. M1 plus M2 is, tell me, minus, complete, 2H by B, not A, Shatej, B, B, B. And M1 into M2 is A by B. Okay, so please remember this. Okay. Yeah, it's very easy to, you know, swap the position of A and B also. Okay, so it is M1 plus M2 is minus 2H by B, and M1, M2 is A by B. Pranav Dharma Gadi, where were you, my dear friend? Long time no see. Not coming in the class also. Everything okay? I mean, health-wise, everything is okay. I hope you don't have any issues. Okay, fine. So you may tell me separately also, not on this forum. So you were not there for the last at least 3-4 classes, I think. Anyways, so now I have to find the equation of the bisectors. So let me make the bisectors with blue color. So let's say this is one bisector. So it is bisecting the, let's say, acute angle between it. And this is another bisector, which is bisecting. Oh, let me change the color. Why to keep the same color? Let me make it in gray. So the gray line is bisecting the obtuse angle between them. And of course, you would already know from your straight lines chapters that this angle will be a 90 degree. So angle between the bisectors will be a 90 degree. Okay. And let's say these two bisectors, I am naming it as B1 and B2, just for the reference of calling them. So B1 is the acute angle bisector, B2 is the obtuse angle bisector here. Anyway, so I need the combined equation of B1, B2. So how do I get the combined equation? Any suggestion anybody has? Okay, so can we realize that if you take any point on the bisector, okay, if you take any H, K point on the bisector, What was the basic principle of deriving the equation of the bisectors in straight line chapter of class 11th? We used to say that the perpendicular distance of this point from the two lines would be equal. So these two distances used to be equal, isn't it? Right? So assume that your line is y equal to m1x and y equal to m2x. So can I use the fact that if I take a generic point, Pm, Pn should be equal? So that is the core principle, or that is the locus definition of getting the equation of the bisectors. So Pm should be equal to Pn. Now what is P? Now this line you may write it as a general form like this, and this line you can write it as a general form like this. So what is the distance of h comma k from y minus m1x equal to 0? So we'll say, sir, simple, mod k minus m1h by under root of 1 plus m1 square. This should be equal to the distance of p from the second line, that is y is equal to m2x. So that perpendicular distance will be k minus m2h mod by under root of 1 plus m2 square. Now these kind of things you should start, you know, realizing on your own, because your locus conditions, that will be tested for your competitive exams. Okay, so these type of situations, you should be able to derive. Don't treat this as if a theory has been told to you. You should be able to get to these kind of equations. Okay, now, of course, my equation only has A, B, N, H. Okay, and here you can see there's M1, M2 also appearing, right? So I cannot generalize it over here. Okay, so what I'll do is, I'll do some calculations here. I will try to get M1 and M2 out of this game, okay? By using these two conditions, that is M1 plus M2 is minus 2H by B and M1, M2 is A by B. So I have to use these two equations and try to eliminate my M1 and M2 from this locus relation or locus condition. Let us see how do we do that. So first I will, if you want, I can put my Y and X directly over here, and then we can go for the simplification part, because ultimately we have to replace K with Y and H with X. So why not do it now only, so that, yeah. So let's cross multiply and square it. So it'll be 1 plus M2 square Y1 minus M1 X square is equal to 1 plus M1 square Y minus M2 X the whole square. Okay. Now let us try collecting your coefficients. So first I will collect the coefficients of Y square. So Y square coefficients would be, so M2 square will come from here and M1 square will come from here. So M2 square minus M1 square. Let's collect similarly the coefficients of X square. X square coefficients will be M1 square minus M2 square. Okay. And let's collect the coefficient of XY also. Okay. So XY coefficient will be, if I'm not mistaken, 2M2 minus M1. Correct? Sorry, 2m. Okay. And the constant terms would be, if I'm not mistaken, it will be minus 2. Oh, there are more terms. Sorry, for xy terms, there will be more terms. Oh, 1 second. I missed out those terms. Yeah. So there will be more terms. You'll have 2m2 minus m1, and we'll also have minus 2m1 m2 m2 minus m1. Please have a look at it and let me know if I missed out anything important. Okay. Now let's try to simplify this. So this is M2 square minus M1 square. This is also minus X square M2 square minus M1 square. Okay. And here also I can take M2 minus M1 common. So you can take 2 common xy m2 minus m1 common, and you'll have 1 minus m1 m2. Okay. Now m1 and m2 are not equal, so you can drop the factor of m1 minus m2. So this becomes m1 plus m2. I can club these two actually together. So I can say m1 plus m2 times x square, y square minus x square. And here I will get 2xy, 1 minus m1, m2. Okay. Now, if you see here, you already have achieved terms like m1 plus m2 and m1 into m2. So please replace m1 plus m2 with minus 2h by b and m1 into m2 with a by b. So when you make these replacements, let us see what do we get over here. So here, what I'm going to do, I'm going to just swap the positions of x square and y square so that negative sign is taken care. Okay. And this is 1 minus a by b. Okay. So b also you can just remove from everywhere and multiply here with a b. Okay. So from here, we end up getting x square minus y square into 2h is equal to 2xy a minus b. 2 also you can get rid of. Okay. So normally in the books, you will realize that they write the final equation like this. Okay. Maybe it helps you to remember the equation also. So this becomes your equation of the pair of bisectors b1, b2. So this is the equation of the pair of bisectors b1, b2. Okay. Now, quick analysis about this equation. But before that, please note this down. Many people ask, sir, we should remember this equation. I would say, yes, my dear, you have to remember it because it would be required in some complicated problem. And again, remembering doesn't mean you'll sit and finally mug up all the formula existing in coordinate geometry. You have to keep solving problems in order to keep it fresh in your mind. Simple as that. It's like you don't remember to do a cycling. You do cycling every day and hence you end up remembering it. So please keep this in your mind in the same way. Any questions, any concerns with respect to the derivation or with respect to the concept use? I think after this step, you should directly understand that it's all about simplification and getting your M1 and M2 eliminated from here. Okay. So let's do a few quick analysis on this. So related to the bisector equation, one thing that you would observe here is that the coefficient of x square and y square, they add up to give you zero. So what is the coefficient of x square here? Coefficient of x square here is 1 by a minus b. And what is the coefficient of y square over here? Negative of that. Correct? So when the coefficient of x square and y square add up to give you zero, what does it tell you about the component lines? What does it tell you about the component lines? In ax square plus 2hxy plus by square equal to zero, if a plus b adds up to give you zero, what does it mean? Yes, it means that the lines are b1 and b2 are perpendicular to each other. And that's precisely what we already have discovered earlier also. Okay. So while making the diagram, I already told you that these two bisectors will be perpendicular as we have learned in class 11th as well. Okay. So that thing is getting valid over here. So that is good. Okay. Second thing important here is many people ask, sir, what will happen if a and b are equal? Okay. So you may get a pair of straight lines whose a and b are equal. Then what will you do? Because zero will come here in the denominator, no? So in that case, what do we say? Use a symbolic representation. If you use a symbolic representation, you'll automatically get x square minus y square is equal to zero. In short, x equal to y and x equal to minus y will become the pair of bisectors for those lines where a and b are equal to each other. Similarly, you may also have a pair of straight lines given to you where your h may be zero. Correct? So if your h is zero, again, use a symbolic representation here that if your h is zero, then this zero goes on the other side and your xy becomes zero. That means your coordinate axes. That means your coordinate axes, that is your x-axis and the y-axis themselves, they act as your pair of, or you can say component bisectors. Okay, so their combined equation is xy equal to zero. So xy equal to zero is what? Your coordinate axis equation combined, isn't it? X-axis is y equal to zero, y-axis is x equal to zero. So the combined equation of the coordinate axes themselves is xy equal to zero, right? So please make a note of this. Let's take a small problem based on the same. Could you show the diagram on the last equation once? Oh, this diagram? Yeah, why not? Right, Shraddha? You want me to show you this equation also? Let me know once you're done. Great. So let's take questions. Yeah, so you have a question here which asks you to find the equation of the bisectors of the angle between the lines represented by this. Just a hands-on on the concept. That's it. Done. Simple, just use of the formula. So your A is a 3 here, B is a 4 here, H is a minus 5 by 2. So what is, and this is a homogeneous equation also. So for homogeneous equations, our pair of bisectors, one important thing I would like to tell you here, even though it is a very, trivial reminder, that you are basically given a homogeneous equation. And what we derived was only for a homogeneous equation. So what if it is a general second degree equation for a pair of straight lines? How would the bisectors change? We will talk about it in some time. Don't worry about it. Okay. So as per the formula that we have used, so your A will be 3, B will be 4. Okay. And your XY will be minus 5 by 2. Okay. So you can write x square minus y square upon minus 1 is equal to 2xy by minus 5. Just do a cross multiplication and simplify it. So that will give you minus 5x square plus 5y square plus 2xy equal to 0. You can write it as 5x square minus 2xy minus 5y square is equal to 0. Okay. So this is your desired result. Is it fine? Any questions? Just as a hands-on on the formula, that's why I gave you this particular question. Is it fine? Any questions, any concerns? Okay. Should I go to the next question? If x square minus 2pxy minus y square equal to 0 and x square minus 2qxy minus y square is equal to 0 be such pairs of straight line that each pair bisects the angle between the other pair. The angle between the other pair. Then find the value of PQ. So read the question. So there are two pairs here. One is this pair, another is pair, and each pair bisects the angle between the other pair. Very good, Kinshuk. Aditya, no, that is not right. Check it out. Okay, should we discuss it? See, very simple. Focus on one of the lines. Okay, let's say I focus on the first pair. Let me call it as pair one, pair two. Okay. So as per pair one, A is one, B is minus one, and H is minus P. Correct. So if I have to write a pair of bisectors what are the bisector equations for pair one? X square minus y square by a minus b is 2 is xy by minus p. Okay, so here if you see, the combined equation will be minus p x square plus py square, and you will have minus 2xy of the bisectors. Now, as per the question setter is claiming that this actually is the P2 pair. This actually should be the P2 pair, correct? So in other words, we need to do a comparison of minus px square minus 2xy plus py square equal to 0 along with the given bisector pair P2, the given pair P2, and that is negative, x square minus 2 qxy minus y square equal to 0. Okay, so let's do a coefficient comparison. So as per the given problem, these two should represent the same pair. So minus p by 1 is equal to minus 2 by minus 2 q is same as p by minus 1. Of course, the first and the last expression doesn't mean the same thing. So you just have to compare these two. So from here, you can say 2pq is equal to minus 2. So pq value is equal to minus 1. Okay. Actually, this problem is a very well-known question also, and it is asked in several regional entrance exams also. JE is one of them. I mean, many a time this question is actually asked. Okay. So last year, I think people told me, said this question is seen almost everywhere. So we have ended up remembering the result. PQ is minus 1. Yeah. So please note this down. Any question that you have, do let me know. Show the right part. Right part is this part, Siddhant. Can you please draw the lines for this? Same set of lines. No? See, they both will be perpendicular lines. One pair will be this. Why? Because x square and y square coefficients are adding up to 0, isn't it? Another will be like this. The yellow ones are one pair. The gray ones are another pair. Okay. So this angle and this angle is equal. This angle and this angle is equal. Okay. And of course, the yellow ones are at 90 degree. The gray ones are also at 90 degree. This is the situation. Got it, Siddhant? So each bisects the angle between the others, and both are pair of perpendicular lines passing through origin. Any questions? So can we comment on the angles? Angles as in angles between what? The angle between these two? Yeah. Has to be 45 degrees, isn't it? Won't it be? If this 90 degrees bisected, this is going to be 45 degrees. Okay. Now we are going to talk about the general equations. General equation of pair of straight lines. I think we had already spoken about it in the beginning part of the chapter. So now we have gone past the homogeneous equations, and now we are going to talk about such lines which not only have x square, xy, y square term, but may also have x, y, and a constant term in the equation. Okay. So basically, it just tells you that such a line is a line which is not, or which may not be passing through the origin, right? So their point of intersection is something which is, you know, not the origin. Okay. If at all they intersect. So I don't mean to say that they will always intersect. They may also represent pair of parallel lines also. Okay. So in such cases, your point of intersection of the lines, if at all they intersect, need not be origin or will not be origin, depending upon your GFNC value. Okay. So the first thing that I'm going to do is, if these lines intersect, So let's say I call this equation as E. So if E represents the pair of lines that intersect, okay, then let us find out the point of intersection. So let's find out the point of intersection. Okay. How would you find the point of intersection? So for point of intersection, I already told you the process is you consider this equation to be, or you consider this term to be, or expression to be S. So simultaneously solve dou S by dou X equal to zero and dou S by dou Y equal to zero. Okay. So let us do that. Let us figure out what is the point of intersection and is there any way that we can remember the point of intersection? So dou S by dou Y, dou S by dou X will give you 2AX. 2AX. This will be 2HY. This will be 2G equal to zero. Drop the factor of twos. It is not going to be important. Okay. Similarly, dou S by dou Y. Dou S by dou Y will be 2BY. So let me write BY. This will give you 2HX. So let me write HX. And this will give us 2F. So let me just write an F because two factors, I am just removing it off. Right? Now, let us use our Cramer's rule to get my value of X. In fact, I should write minus Y and 1. Cross multiplication method I am using. So HF minus BG. This will be AF minus GH. Okay. And this will be AB minus H square. Okay. So we normally write X value as HF minus BG by AB minus H square and Y value as AF minus GH by H square minus AB. So remember there's a minus sign sitting over here. So I just switch the position of H square and AB. Now in order to make it consistent, okay, so we'll write it as BG minus HF by H square minus AB, comma AF minus GH by H square minus AB. Is this fine? Now, there is a way to remember this result. If you remember the delta expression that we had seen when we were talking about the condition for a pair or a condition of a second degree equation to represent a pair of straight lines, the delta value or the delta expression used to be this, isn't it? Okay. So in this, what do? You take the first two rows elements like this, A, H, H, B, G, F, and then repeat AH over here. So I'm just telling you a way to remember, memory aid. Now see here, this term will be your denominators, AB minus H square. Now here I have changed the position. It doesn't matter even if you keep AB minus H square. So this term, the term which is coming from this operation will be your denominator for every term. Okay. This HF minus BG will be the numerator for the X coordinate. Okay. And similarly, GH minus AF will be the numerator for the Y coordinate. So you can remember the result like this. So the yellow one, first write HF minus BG divided by the white one, that will become your X coordinate. Similarly, GH minus AF, that is your second yellow crisscross, divided by the white one again, that will become your Y coordinate of the point of intersection. So this is how you can remember the formula for the point of intersection in case you want to use it. Else, if you have numbers, you can always, you know, use the numbers to get to solve this equation. Okay. So, I've told you how to remember the point of intersection just to save time. If you are not able to remember this, you know, you will not lose anything other than few seconds maybe a few half a minute or something. Okay, so this is the coordinate of the pair of the coordinate of intersection of the pair of straight lines, if at all they intersect. Now there are certain things over here which will tell you when will they not intersect. Okay, when will they not intersect? Okay, so we'll do a small analysis over here. Aditya, not completely correct. We'll talk about it. Our next discussion will be based on that only. So now we will be talking about what is the situation when this pair of straight lines, okay, may be representing two parallel lines or may be representing two coincident lines. So what are the conditions that it must satisfy? So here I'm assuming that they are intersecting at a point. But who knows that they may be intersecting at no point at all. That means they may be parallel. Right, so they could be three situations. They could be like this, they could be like this, or they could be one over the other. Okay, who knows, isn't it? So we'll be trying to analyze this situation. Right now, what we have seen is a very sober case where they are intersecting at one point. But again, it all depends upon what is your H, A, and B. So this is just a formula which needs to be analyzed into more detail. Okay. So if the pair of straight lines represent parallel lines, what will happen? If they represent coincident lines, what will happen to these coordinates? That also we need to look into our analysis. Okay. So let me go to the next page and start doing that analysis. If everybody has noted this, can we move on to the next page? But before we move on, I would like to take a simple question just to, you know, give you an idea about the use of dou s by dou x and dou s by dou y equal to zero. Given that this represents a pair of straight lines which intersect at a point, okay, find the point of intersection. I would request not to use the formula, but directly come from your dou s by dou x equal to zero, dou s by dou y equal to zero, and try to solve them simultaneously. Two comma one is absolutely right. Simple. So again, go from the basics. The basic was we have to simultaneously solve dou s by dou x and dou s by dou y equal to zero equation. So this is going to give you a 4x. Okay. This is going to give you a minus 7y minus 1 equal to zero. Okay. And this is going to give you a minus 7x minus 8y plus 22 equal to 0. Let's solve them simultaneously. Okay. So let's multiply this with, or we can use our cross multiplication method itself here. So this will be minus 154 minus 154 minus 8. This will be 88 minus 7. And this is going to be minus 32 minus 49. Correct? Yeah. So this is nothing but x by 162. This is nothing but y by minus 81. And this is 1 by minus 81. So your x value has to be 2, y value has to be 1. Yes. So point of intersection is going to be 2, 1. No issues? Okay. Now let's talk about conditions. Condition for a second degree equation. To represent coincident lines. To represent coincident lines. Coincident line means both the lines are actually the equation of the same thing, but may differ from each other by a proportionality constant. So let's try to figure out what are the conditions that must be honored if you are basically talking about a pair of straight lines which are coincident to each other. Okay, so let's try to look into that situation. So here, let us say our pair of straight lines is composed of Lx plus my plus, let's say, n, and l dash x m dash y plus n dash. Okay, so let us say this pair of straight lines is composed of these two lines where the lines are coincident. So lines are coincident means l by l dash, m by m dash, and n by n dash should be equal. That's the only way you can basically claim that the two lines which are basically making this pair of straight line equation are coincident. Okay. So only coincident lines will show this particular type of characteristic, isn't it? So we already know that if these two lines are coincident lines, means they're one and the same equations, then I can say that the ratio of the coefficients of x should be same as the ratio of coefficient of y should be same as the ratio of coefficient of your constant term, because they are representing same lines, just differing. They may differ in constant terms. That is why I'm taking the ratio. I'm not doing a direct comparison. I'm not saying L is equal to L dash. Okay. Because something like this could also be there, no? Plus 1 equal to 0 and the other is 3x plus 3y plus 3 equal to 0. Both are coincident lines. Or you can say both are two equations of the very same line. Okay. So this could be a scenario. Now, first of all, what I'll do a coefficient comparison. So let's do a coefficient comparison. So let's take our x square coefficient on both the sides and compare it. So L, L dash will become A. M, M dash will become B. Correct? N, N dash, that is the constant terms, will become a C. Correct? Can I say L, M dash, L dash, M will become a 2H? Okay, so when this multiplies with this, this multiplies with this, I'll get a XY coefficient and that is equal to, why my Y is looking like a G? Yeah, so that will become 2H. Okay, similarly, L, N dash, L dash N is equal to 2G. M dash N is equal to 2F. Okay. Now, since this condition is true, since this condition is true, can I say, can I say from here, let me write it here. Can I say, if I take the first pair, can I say LM dash minus L dash M is zero? Can I also say MN dash minus M dash N will also be zero from this? Okay. And finally, we can also claim that LN dash minus L dash N will also be zero. Okay. Now, if you use this, can I say it is as good as saying LM dash L dash M whole square is zero? And what is whole square? Whole square of this can also be written as LM dash plus L dash M whole square minus 4 L L dash M M dash. Basically, I've used A minus B whole square as A plus B whole square minus 4 AB formula. Okay. Now, why did I actually write it like this? Because you have information about LM dash plus L dash M, which is actually 2H. Okay. So this will become 2H the whole square. And you have information about LL dash, which is A, and MM dash, which is B. Okay. So please note, H square is equal to AB is one of the necessary conditions for it to represent coincident lines. So this is just one of the conditions, Aditya. Okay. So please make a note of this. This is our first condition. Okay. The other conditions also must be met. That means the second one. So I'll write it similarly. Please do let me know if you feel I have jumped any steps which you wanted to know from me. Same thing. I'm not writing anything separate. It's the same approach. Correct? And what is this? What is this M N dash plus N dash M? That is equal to 2F, isn't it? So I can say this is going to be 2F the whole square minus 4. What is M M dash? M M dash is B. N N dash is C. So this is B C. Okay. So this should be zero. In other words, F square should be equal to B C. This is your second condition. Okay. And similarly, from the last one, LN dash, let me keep it in yellow only, LN dash minus L dash N is zero, or square of this is zero. That means LN dash plus L dash N, the whole square minus 4 LL dash NN dash is equal to zero. That means G square, 2G square minus 4AC is zero. So G square should be equal to AC. Okay. So now please note this down. Very, very important. So from 1, 2, and 3, what we come to know, the conditions that are supposed to be met, the conditions for the pair to represent, coincident lines is number one, H square should be equal to AB, but that is not sufficient. Only this will not tell you, because H square is equal to AB is for one more situation. We will see in some time. Apart from that, you should have F square should be equal to BC and G square should be equal to AC. So many a times a direct multiple option correct question is framed in the JE Advanced exam for this pair to represent a pair of straight lines. Which of the following conditions must be true? And you have to mark all the three. Okay. Now from here, lot of, you know, other conditions also come into picture, because some derived conditions can also come into picture. For example, if you multiply both the sides, you'll end up getting F square. So last two, if you multiply, you end up getting something like this. And you already know AB is H square, isn't it? So you can write it like this also. Correct. Or you can say FH is equal to, this could be a condition, right? Who knows? This could be a condition. Okay. So what I'm trying to say here is that the question that may be asked or given to you to solve may not be directly stating these three conditions, but something derived from it. Are you getting what I'm trying to say? So they may divide it also. They will say, okay, is this a condition to be true? Or is AF square should be equal to BG square? Then yes, because from these two, this condition might come into picture. Are you getting my point? So these are the things which they may ask you in your options, and you have to be careful about it. So these are the three basic conditions. From here, a lot of conditions can be derived, and that depends on the question. I cannot sit and give you all the conditions. So this is an example of a derived condition, something like that. Is it fine? Any questions, any concerns that you have, do let me know. Okay. Now we'll talk about when does it represent, or what is the condition to be satisfied when they represent a pair of parallel lines. So primary conditions for ax square plus 2hxy plus by square plus 2gx plus 2fy plus c equal to 0 to represent parallel lines. Okay. I just want to know if you are Anurag is in HSR or is in YPR? Anurag Bijay. He's an HSR student? Okay. If anybody is in touch with him, just do let him know that I was wondering why he's not coming for classes. This entire year, he has been very dicey. Okay. See, these are very, very critical moments for you. Right now, if you let loose the hold on your preparation, it is going to be a giant fall. Okay. So keep running. I know you are all very tired mentally, but keep running. If you stop here, you lose the race. And that repent will be more painful. Okay. So some of you have seen, I don't want to name the people here in this session. Some of you have given up badly in the last 4 or 5 months. Those who are consistent, that will definitely pay you off. Okay. So please don't let go your preparation hold at this juncture. There is life after class 12th also. Okay. Anyways, so let's discuss this condition. So for this, again, we will have a similar approach. In fact, I wanted to give this as a homework question, but I would just do it for you. Okay. So in this case, what do we say? If they represent parallel lines, let the parallel lines be these lines. Okay. Where n and n dash are not equal to each other. Rest, I've kept the coefficient of x square, y square. I have kept the coefficients to be the same. Okay. So here also, if you compare, you get L square as A, you get M square as B, and you get H as, correct me if I'm wrong, that will give you LM. Okay. LM, this also LM. So 2LM is 2HXY. I'm just directly comparing it. And the X term would be, G term would be, let me write it like this. LM terms to left and our given terms to the right. Yeah. Yes. So this is going to be your, this thing. And X term will be, correct me if I'm wrong. So X term here would be N dash or LN dash plus LN, or you can say L common, N dash plus N, that will be equal to 2G. And similarly, MN dash and MN. So M could be taken common. This is equal to 2F, and constant is NN dash, which is equal to C. Now here, here, what condition do you think must be satisfied for them to represent parallel lines? Tell me. Same, I think if you see here, h square is equal to l square m square, and that is also equal to product of ab. So this condition will still come out to be true. S square is equal to ab. So s square equal to ab condition will be true for both the scenarios, whether you have the lines are coincident or whether they are parallel. So this condition is true even for coincident lines. Coincident lines as well as parallel lines. Okay. What else can I say? I can see from here that L by M is equal to G by F. Isn't it? A lot of things can be said here. If you square both the sides, it is as good as saying A by B is equal to G square by F square. Correct? That means AF square is equal to BG square also can be said, correct? And if you remember this condition, I think I deleted it or something. Okay. Yeah. So if I divide this, so this condition comes from these two equations also combined. So please be very, very careful about, you know, what are you basically planning to, get from the options. Okay, so this condition is also true when you had coincident lines, right? But are the equations satisfying these two conditions also individually? That is also to be kept in mind. Is F square is equal to BC and G square is equal to AC for this case? That will not happen. Okay, that is not going to happen. So please understand here that the conditions are very similar to each other, but you have to see in combination, they will satisfy a condition for you to represent coincident lines. And in combination, they will satisfy an equation for you to represent parallel lines. So if these two are simultaneously satisfied, okay, then you could have any of the two cases. We have to check out which will be the differentiator for it to be coincident line and which will be the differentiator for it to be parallel lines. Okay. And now I will tell you the differentiator also. The differentiator is in this case, F square minus BC and G square minus AC is the differentiator. So in the second case, when it is representing parallel lines, in this case, you would realize G square will not be equal to AC and F square will not be equal to BC. Okay, so these two conditions will not be satisfied. Okay, G square is not equal to AC and F square will not be equal to BC for this case. Now, many people say, sir, how did you get this? Now see, if the two lines are representing parallel lines, so if let's say one is LX plus MY plus N is equal to zero and LX plus MY plus N dash is equal to zero. Okay. Now, what would be the distance between the two parallel lines? If I ask you, what would be the distance between the two parallel lines? If you have remembered, we had done distance between parallel lines in our class 11th straight lines chapter. I'm sorry, it is n minus n dash by under root of coefficient of x square and y square. Correct. Now, if you see n minus n dash modulus could be written as n plus n dash the whole square minus 4 n n dash under root divided by under root L square plus M square. Correct. Now, what is n plus n dash? Let's try to get it either from this equation or from this equation. So let us use this one first. I could use the second one as well. So if I use this from here, I would get n plus n dash as 2g by l. So let me put it over here. Okay. For n dash can be obtained from the last equation, which is equal to c. Okay. Whole divided by l square m square. Now, let me just write it completely in terms of g, a, c, etc. So this will become 4g square minus 4l square c under root by under root of l will come down under root of l square plus m square. Now remember l square was a. Remember l square was a. So what I'm going to do here, I'm going to write this as 4. In fact, let me take it outside the under root. So 2 under root of g square minus ac. Correct. This will be root a. This will be a plus b because m square is a b. So in short, you'll end up getting something like this. In fact, I would like you to note this result down because this result gives you the distance between the parallel lines which comprise the pair of straight lines. So please note this down. And if they really represent pair of parallel lines, remember the numerator term should not be zero because then the distance between them will become a zero, right? So if they represent parallel lines, this will not be zero. While in the previous case, if you see g square was equal to ac, look at the last condition, g square was equal to ac. That means your distance will become zero. So this is the distinguishing factor, right? This will tell you that, oh no, this is not a coincident line. This is going to be parallel lines. So there will be a lot of common conditions and there will be a lot of distinguishers also. These are the distinguishers. Are you getting my point? But this individually will not help you because this may be not zero for even lines which may be like not in either of the two. So please do not read them as a self-sufficient conditions. You have to analyze several conditions in order to come to a conclusion. Okay. Now, many people say, sir, if you had used the second condition, that is n plus n dash is 2f by m, then what would you have got? If I had used n plus n dash is equal to 2f by m, if I had used this condition, then my distance between two parallel lines, I don't know why my voice is cracking. Then the distance between two parallel lines here would have become 2 under root of f square minus bc by under root of b a plus b. Correct me if I'm wrong. Okay. And both of these are equal in value. If they represent parallel lines, they both will give you equal result because both represent the distance between the two lines. Okay. And here also, if you see, if you want them to represent parallel lines, means the numerator should not be zero. That means this term should not be zero. Then only you will get a parallel line. Okay. So many people ask me, sir, this result and this result, do we need to remember? Yes. So please remember this as well. Sir, how many things to remember? Don't worry. This is the last set of formulas that you will be remembering. Okay. Any questions? So mostly my experience tells me that the question that would be asked from pair of straight lines, if at all the question examiner has to confuse you, they either put it from these concept of coincident and parallel lines, or they ask you the concept of homogenization, which I'm going to do in next few minutes with you. Okay. So just to summarize what I want to say, if you want to have parallel lines, h square should be equal to ab. Okay. And we also discovered that BG square should be equal to AF square, right? But we also discovered that G square will not be equal to AC and F square will not be equal to BC. Okay, just these two, if you take, it may represent coincident line also. Getting my point, what I'm trying to say. What happened to my voice here? Okay, good enough. Any questions, any concerns, do let me know. Now, coming to the equation of bisectors. Coming to the equation of bisectors for a general second degree pair of straight lines. For general equation of pair of straight lines. In this case, there is shift of origin, which basically helps you. Now see, if this was origin, okay, if this was origin, that means your pair of straight line was a homogeneous equation, homogeneous second degree equation, then your equation would have been this, which we had already seen in our derivation today in the morning. Okay, first thing that we did was we derived this equation. But now if you want x1, y1 to come over here, then what are you doing? Where are you shifting your origin to? Can anybody tell me that? If you want x1, y1 to come in place of the origin, right? Where are you shifting your origin to? If you want to this to become x1, y1, where should the origin go? Minus x1, y1. Yes. So if you shift your origin to minus x1, minus y1, how would this equation change? How would this equation change? When you shift your origin to h, k, how does your x become? It becomes this. Y becomes this. Am I not right? Yes. In a similar way, small x will become capital X plus H. H is, my dear, minus X1. Don't confuse. Okay. Now, it is not a good practice. It is not a good practice to write things in capital. So, we'll write things in small. So, please make a note of this. So if at all you are given a pair of straight lines, which you realize is not a homogeneous second degree equation, that means they do not represent a pair of straight lines passing through the origin, then just quickly do a small activity, find out their point of intersection. Because if the question has come to find out the bisector, they must be intersecting. So what is that find a point of intersection? Just find it out. So what is the algo here? The algo here is, number one, get x1, y1. How? By simultaneously solving these two equations. Once you get it, all you need to do, use your equation x square minus y square by a minus b is equal to xy minus h, where your x will now be replaced with x minus x1 that you obtained from step number one, and y will be replaced with y minus y1. Sorry, this is minus. And this x1, y1, you would have already obtained from step number one. Is it clear? Any questions? Any questions? Any concerns? Okay, good. So we are now, Aditya has a question. Sir, we are trying to get this one to behave like, or yes, yes. So what you're doing, see, you're using the concept of shifting of the origin. A general second degree equation may not pass through origin. I mean, may not intersect at origin. So what you're doing is you're shifting the entire situation such that the pair of straight lines intersect at x1, y1. So in short, you are basically using the pair of equations at the origin, bisectors, and you're shifting it by x1, y. Origin is being shifted in such a way that they represent the bisectors of the general second degree equation. So it's a shifting of origin concept that is utilized, nothing else. Got it, Aditya? All right. So we'll just take, I'm just searching for a good question, if at all I have one. Okay. Maybe we'll take the same. Yeah. Find the equations of bisectors of, by the way, this equation which I am giving you, I have already given you in one of the questions before to find out the point of intersection so that now you don't waste time finding the point of intersection. So for this, the point of intersection was 2, 1. Okay. So please write down the equation of the bisectors. I just want everybody to have a hands-on on this. This is not a difficult question. Just have a practice of how do you write it. Okay. No need to simplify. No need to simplify at all. Just write it and tell me done. It is just a 1 minute, activity. You just have to fill in the requisites here, x1, y1. Okay. So x1 is already 2, y1 is already 1, a minus b. So in this case, a minus b will be 6. Okay. And I'm not asking you to simplify it also. Let it be in this form itself. You can simplify it when actual thing comes. And h here is minus 7/2. So this 2 will go up. Okay. Simplify it. And that is your pair of bisectors for this general second degree equation. Okay. Now the last concept for the topic, the concept of homogenization. Okay, so what is this homogenization concept? A very, you can say, important concept, especially for people preparing for JEE Advanced and all. This concept comes from the concept of homogeneous second degree equation, right? So if you know there is a homogeneous second degree equation and your h square is greater than or equal to ab, then it must represent a pair of straight lines passing through the origin, or pair of straight lines intersecting at the origin. Okay. Now, when you have, remember that concept which I just now told. Now I'm giving you another situation. Let's say if you have a conic, okay, any conic, whether it's a circle or whether it's a parabola, it's hyperbola, ellipse. Okay. So let's say this is a conic. Okay, it could be pair of straight lines also. Okay, so let's say this is a conic given to you. Okay, this conic is basically cut by a line, let's say blue line. Okay, and this blue line equation is Lx plus My plus N equal to 0. Okay, and let's say the point of intersection here is P and Q. Okay, now if you are connecting the origin to these point of intersection, okay, you can see that here it is creating a pair of straight lines. In fact, if you can extend this further also, okay, just to make it realize that it is like looking like a straight line only. So the combined equation of L1 and L2, which is basically a pair of lines connecting the origin to the point of intersection of the line with this conic, then combined equation is given by the combined pair of L1 and L2 equation is given by homogenizing the line with this conic. Now, what is the meaning of homogenizing the line with this conic? So what it does, it converts the entire conic equation into a uniform second degree equation like this. All of you, please pay attention. So this 2gx, now see, this is a first degree term. See, this is second degree term, second degree term, second degree term, right? So I need to make a second degree equation, then only I'll get L1 and L2 equation combined, right? Because we have learned that a pair of straight lines, which is intersecting at the origin, is a homogeneous second degree equation. That means all the terms in that equation must be uniformly second degree, second degree, second degree, second degree, right? But this is first degree, 2gx. So what I do here, I'll do it in the next step. Let me write a 1 for the time being there. Similarly, 2fy is also a first degree. So I have to make it second degree. So I'll put a 1 there as of now. Just note it down. As of now, I'm putting 1. And c is again a 0 degree. So I'll put a 1 square there. Now see what I'm going to do. From this equation, I'm going to do lx plus my is equal to minus n. So lx plus my by minus n is equal to 1. And this 1, I'm going to put over here, here, and here. Let's see how. So this is how I am going to do it. So second degree terms are okay because they're already second degree. Let's not bother them. And this 1 over here, I will write it as lx plus my by minus n. Now you can see here, I have created a second degree here as well. See, 2gx into lx, x square will come, second degree term. 2gx my, xy will come, again a second degree, correct? Similarly, here also, I will write the same 2fy, lx plus my by minus n. Again, a second degree term is created. Second degree terms are created here, correct? 2fyx, lx, second degree term will be coming up. And the last term, I'll just use the square of this, which is lx plus my by minus n the whole square. So now this equation will be, I mean, I'm not simplifying it. Okay, and you don't need to simplify it because you can directly use your actual figures given to you in the question. So this second degree equation will be representing a pair of straight lines connecting L1 and L2 from the origin. Now, many people say, sir, why? It could represent any curve passing through P and Q, any conic passing through P and Q. Agreed. Any conic passing through P and Q can be given by this equation, but can any conic satisfy that it is being a second degree equation where h square is greater than ab? Only a pair of straight lines can satisfy that condition, right? So this actually will only represent a pair of straight line connecting the origin to the points P and Q. They cannot be any other conic. So here you are basically using the combined effect of family of curves along with condition of homogenization, which basically will lead only to one family member, and that is a pair of straight lines connecting origin to P and Q. Very important concept, and people even don't know that, oh, here I could have used the concept of homogenization. Okay, it is so hidden, it is so, you know, obscure and discrete that many people are not able to figure it out that, yeah, I could have used concept of homogenization to solve it. Okay, so please note down, make a star next to this in case you want to. We will take a question on this. Don't worry. Yes. Right. If you would have just taken this plus lambda, the line, you could have got a conic passing through the intersection of the line and the given conic. The first equation is any conic which has been intersected by that given blue line, Weber. Okay. And this, what you have got is the equation of L1 and L2 combined. Huh, the first one represents the curve. See, I've written, no, the first one represents this curve. So curve will be known, line will be known, and then L1, L2 equations combined you are trying to find out. Okay. All right, so we'll take some question. I think I have taken one question just for your understanding. We'll do this question. And of course, I'll be sending you DPPs for you to work on. So you can consider this to be our last question for conic section. So we completed circle, ellipse, parabola, hyperbola, pair of straight lines successfully. Do you think we could have completed this in our first year itself? So much of volume was there. Not possible. Prove that the lines joining the origin to the point of intersection of the straight lines with this curve, the angle between them is this. So they are basically coming from a different perspective. Then they're not only asking you for the lines combined equation, but also to find out the angles between them. So if you get the combined equation, you can always get the angle between them. So please try it out. I'm giving you 3 minutes to try this out. Just homogenize, simplify, see what you get. JE Advanced people, I'll be sending you the link just after the class for the test. And KVPY, see, it is your call. If you want to write KVPY today and JE Advanced tomorrow, that is fine. JE Advanced today, KVPY tomorrow, that is also fine. Your call. You can write it anytime. Yeah, Suman, you can write it anytime. Before I forget, tomorrow, note down everybody, 11:30 to 1:30, you will have chemistry class tomorrow, okay? Fine, so Rajaji Nagar, YPR people, please note this down, 11:30 to 1:30, you will have chemistry class conducted by Prabhat sir. It is only for YPR. No, it is for everybody, all batches. Combined class. Siddhant, it is for everybody. Just like I tipped maths class, no, yesterday. Same chemistry class will happen. Okay. Why 11:30? Because Yeshwantpur has some, you know, school classes. That is why we are keeping it at 11:30. Else we would have kept it at 9:00. Okay. Reminder will be sent. Don't worry. Today itself, reminder you will receive. Okay. All right, so let's complete this problem. I think many of you would have done it also. So we need to homogenize this line equation with this equation. So what I'm going to do, I'm going to write 4x into 1. Now see how this 1 I'm going to write. So y minus 3x by 2, I will call it as a 1. Correct. Similarly, 8y and 1 will be again y minus 3x by, y minus 3x by 2. Okay. Minus 11, y minus 3x by 2 the whole square. Fine. Now, I think you have to do some simplification over here. So I'll be just simplifying this result. Multiply throughout with a 4 so that, you know, that last term denominator is taken care of. But in the interest of time, I will directly write it down. So you should be getting something like this, minus 20x square minus 32xy plus 28y square minus, this should give you something like this, 119x square minus 34xy minus 17y square. Am I right? That simplification you can do here. I mean, that is not a rocket science. Okay. Now, for this equation, you need to find out what is the angle between the lines. So we have learned that tan theta is 2 under root of x square minus ab by mod a plus b. Okay. So ask yourself, who is playing the role of h here? 17 is playing the role of h. Correct. So 17 square minus ab. So minus AB plus will be 17 into 119. Correct? Achha, many people say, sir, you can simplify this more. You can write it as 7x square minus 2xy minus y square, isn't it? It can go by a factor of 7. So why to use such a heavy figure? Yeah, let's use a simpler figure. So h square here will be 1 minus 7AB will be plus 7. By mod of a plus b. Mod of a plus b will be mod of 7 minus 1. So that's nothing but 2 into root 8 by 6. That's nothing but root 8 by 3. That's nothing but 2 root 2 by 3. So your theta is tan inverse of 2 root 2 by 3. Is it fine? Any questions, any concerns? Is it okay? So thanks to the concept of homogenization, that you will be able to find it pretty quickly. If somebody doesn't know the concept of homogenization, what will he do? He will unnecessarily sit and find the points of intersection, waste of time. Then he will connect. He will find the slopes of the two lines connecting origin to that point of intersection. Then he will use the formula m1 minus m2 by 1 plus m1 m2 mod is tan theta. So this takes away that, you know, lengthy, you can say, process. And does it in a simpler way. So homogenization, wherever you feel it is going to help you out, please do so. And with this, we come to the end of our conic sections.